Today's agenda would be a hyperbola. Okay, so we are into our last conic, which is hyperbola, and this is only with respect to your school level syllabus. We will be doing hyperbola in much more detail once your school semester exam is over. I've been repeating this since the beginning of the conic, so I'm repeating this yet again, that whatever we are going to do in today's class is only meant for your class 11th CBSC or ISC curriculum. It is not going to help you, or it is not going to be the complete, you can say, JE main, JE advanced or competitive exam content. That content will be definitely taken up once your school semester exam is completed. Okay. So let's get started with hyperbola. So let us look into the locus definition of a hyperbola. By the way, I have already explained to you how a hyperbola is obtained from a right circular double cone. If not, I will explain this yet again to you. So let us say this is a right circular double cone. Okay. It's called a right circular double cone because, as you can see, there are double cones seen in this particular diagram. And it is called right circular because the axis of this cone, or axis of this right circular double cone, is perpendicular to the base. Now, if this right circular double cone is cut by a plane, okay, if this is cut by a plane, let me draw a plane here. Okay, let me just make it slightly more inclined so that you have an idea about, let's say I make it like this. Okay. Nevertheless, the plane is not going to pass through the vertex. Okay. So the cross section area that would be left, I'm just showing it with the blue color. Yeah. This cross section area that you can see on your screen right now will be that of a hyperbola. Okay. Now this angle is what we call as the semi-vertical angle. Let me name it in green color. Okay. And this angle is what we call as the angle beta. Okay. So the plane makes an angle of beta with the axis. So if your beta is between 0 degree, including 0 degree, to alpha, then the cross section area obtained would be that of a hyperbola. Okay. So I hope everybody is clear why these conic sections are named in that way. So if this plane cuts perpendicular to the axis, we end up getting a circle. If the plane cuts the axis in such a way that the angle it makes, that is your beta angle, is lesser than 90 degree but more than alpha, it will be an ellipse. If the angle which the plane makes with the axis is equal to alpha, it's a parabola. If it is lesser than alpha but greater than, of course, greater than equal to zero, it will be a hyperbola. Okay, so this is our last of the conic circles, parabola, ellipse, we have already done in the previous classes. So in this chapter, you would realize that you're doing more or less the similar formula, similar points as what you did in case of ellipse. Okay, so there's a stark resemblance between hyperbola concept and ellipse concept. Okay, so first let us look into the locus definition. What is the locus definition of a hyperbola? So hyperbola is locus of a point or a path traced by a point moving in a plane in such a way that the ratio of its distance from a fixed point to that from a fixed line is a constant where the value of this constant is greater than 1. where the value of this constant is greater than 1. Okay. By the way, we had more or less same definition for ellipse as well, where I told you that the ratio which is a constant is between 0 to 1. So in case of an ellipse, it was between 0 to 1. In case of a parabola, it was equal to 1. In case of a circle, it will be equal to 0. That I've already discussed with you. So eccentricity for a circle is 0. Eccentricity for a parabola, ellipse is between 0 and 1. Eccentricity for a parabola is equal to 1, and eccentricity for a hyperbola is greater than 1. So these points that we are talking about and this line we are talking about is known as your focus. So from a fixed point, So this fixed point is what we call as the focus. This fixed line is what we call as the directrix. And this constant is what we call as the eccentricity. Okay. So your eccentricity is greater than 1 for a hyperbola. Is it fine? Any questions? So let me draw a figure for the same. Let's say this is our directrix and this is our fixed point S. Okay. And let's say there is a moving point P, which moves in such a way, let's say this is your P point, which moves in such a way that SP distance is greater than PM. Okay. So SP is more than PM. That means SP by PM is greater than 1. Okay. So the path traced by such a point would look like a structure, which is going to appear like this. Okay. I'm just drawing one of the arms here. By the way, with the same eccentricity, you can have the same point showing you the same eccentricity value with another set of point and line. In other words, the very same point P, the distance from this point, let me call this as S dash. This divided by PM dash, that would be the same E value. That means S dash P by PM dash will be the same eccentric value. In other words, you have a pair of focus and directrices for hyperbola as well. Okay. And you can well imagine that there would be one more branch of the hyperbola which will look like this. Okay, I'm just drawing the two branches over here. Okay, I'll show you this structure on the GeoGebra tool as well. Okay, so there are two directrices, you can say D and D dash. There are two foci corresponding to these directrices. Please note, just like in case of an ellipse, this focus and this directrix are associated with each other. That means if you are referring to the distance of the point from the focus S, you must take the ratio of its distance from the same point from the directrix D. And if you're taking the ratio of its distance from the focus S dash, you must take the ratio with the distance PM dash. You cannot swap the two foci and the directrices. Please note this down. Okay. Have you all noted this down? A locus definition. Why if a hyperbola is called a conic, and how the directrices and focus situations look like in case of a hyperbola. Let me show this diagram on GeoGebra. Let me show this on GeoGebra. So let's say I just make a hyperbola for you right now. However, most of you who have not done hyperbola would not know the reason why I chose this equation, but I will formally derive it in a few minutes time. Don't worry about it. Okay, so let's say this is our hyperbola. As you can see on your screen, there's a hyperbola. Now, GeoGebra has a feature that it can show you the directrix. So let me show you the directrix of this. So as you can see, it has shown you two lines, F and G. Okay, in fact, it has also given you their equations as well. And it can also show you the focus. It can also show you the focus of the conic. So let me show you that. Okay. Now what I'm going to take here is I'm going to take a generic point. Let's say any point on this hyperbola. Let's say I take it here. Okay. So what's the distance of this point from B? Let's check. H. H is 5.48, as you can see on your screen over here. And let's also drop a perpendicular from this point onto this line. Okay. And let's find out CD length. C to D, they are calling as a J. Okay. Now let's take the ratio of H by J. So H divided by J. Oh, I hope I'm writing the right things down. Yeah, H divided by J. As you can see on your screen, it shows it to be 1.2. Okay. Now, all of you, please pay attention. First of all, I would like to show you that if you take this length also, CA, okay, as you can see, they have called K, and CE, they have called it as L. And if you do K divided by L, see what you get. Again, 1.2. So H by J is also 1.2. K by L is also 1.2. Okay. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to take this point for a trip. Okay. So I'm just going to move it on the hyperbola. When I'm moving it, just observe A and B values. Just observe A and B values. They still remain 1.2. They still remain 1.2. There is no difference in the value of the eccentricity. Even when you're referring to any one of the pair of focus and directrices. Do you see that? Any questions, any concerns? Is it fine? Any questions? So even if I bring it on this, it doesn't make any difference. Okay. All right. So now, having seen the locus definition, we will now derive the equations of standard hyperbole. Just like in case of an ellipse, just like in the case of a circle, just like in the case of a parabola, we had standard cases. Now, who will tell me what was the standard case for circle? Anybody? What used to be the standard form of a circle? Circle whose center is at origin, correct? What used to be the standard cases for the parabola? Parabola whose vertices used to be at origin and the axis of the parabola used to be along one of the coordinate axes, right? What used to be the standard case for an ellipse? When your major and minor axes were your x and the y axis, in other words, the center of the ellipse in that case also used to be at the origin. Yes or no? So even for a hyperbola, we will have two standard cases. So let us take those standard cases. So standard hyperbole. Okay. Or standard hyperbolas also you can call it. Both are the same thing. So standard hyperbola are those cases where, let me write it down, the center of the hyperbola is at origin. Center of the hyperbola is at origin. Okay. And there is something called transverse Oh, I have not told you about the this thing. Not I, I. Let me just write it down first. Transverse and conjugate axis are along the coordinate axes. Okay. So first, let me give you the nomenclature. The reason why I skipped nomenclature probably because it follows the same nomenclature as that of a ellipse. So let me just do one thing. Let me just take the diagram from here itself. Better to draw it again because don't save. So I'll be just picking up my diagram from here itself so that we can use it. Yeah. So first of all, we will let you know the terms that we are using. Okay. So first get yourself familiarized with the term. Now, forget that there is an XY axis over here. Just think as if there are two arms, okay? And let us say these are the two foci. Okay, so these are the two. By the way, I could have as well picked up a diagram with a foci. One second, give me one more second. I'll just put the foci and directrices. Foci and directrices. Yeah. Okay, so the terms that we are going to use is more or less the same as what we use in case of a ellipse. So these are the two foci. So focus number one, this is focus number two. Okay, so these are the two directrices that you already know. Okay, so let me just write it down on top of it. You can say focus one, focus two. Focus one, focus two. And this also you can call it as directrix number one, directrix number two. Okay. Now, the first thing that you should all know is that the line joining the two foci, if I join the two foci, this line that you see here, this line is called the transverse axis. Okay. This line is called as the transverse axis. Okay. I already used the term over here. And then I realized that I have not given you the nomenclature. So nomenclature are the terms that we normally use along with hyperbola. So this is your transverse axis. Transverse axis is a line connecting the two foci. Okay. The midpoint of the two foci is called the center of the, this is called the center of the hyperbola. Okay. The midpoint. So center is the midpoint of the two foci. Okay. Please note that the point where the transverse axis cuts the hyperbola, they are called vertices. Okay. So these two will be called as the vertices. Okay. Center is also the midpoint of the two vertices. Okay. Now, a line passing through the center and perpendicular to the transverse axis. This line is called the conjugate axis. This line is called the conjugate axis. Now there is a story behind why it is called conjugate axis. We will talk about that story in some time, not to worry. Similarly, other things that you have already learned in ellipse, those will be anyways be valid. If you connect any two points, okay, it will be called as a chord. Okay, so this is a chord. By the way, many people ask me, sir, can I connect a point from here to here and call this as a chord? Yes. Yes. Definitely, you can call both of them as chords. So this is also a chord. This is also a chord. Okay. Please don't think that you have to connect two points on the very same branch. No, that's not required. You may connect a line from one taking a point from one branch to a point on the other branch as well. Okay. Next, double ordinate. Double ordinate is nothing but it's a chord which is perpendicular to the transverse axis. Okay, so if I draw a line like this, okay, let me choose a different color. Yeah, this is a different color. Yeah. So this is called a double ordinate. This is called a double ordinate. Let me write it here. Double ordinate. Okay. And the line, or you can say that the double ordinate, which is perpendicular, which is passing through the focus. Okay. By the way, if a chord is passing through the focus, it is called focal chord. We already know it. Okay. So this is a focal chord. You can draw another focal chord here. Okay. Any number of focal chords can be drawn. So these are called focal chords. Focal chords. Okay. And if a double ordinate is passing through the focus, that means if a double ordinate is a focal chord or a focal chord is a double ordinate, then that would be called as a lattice rectum. So this is called as a lattice rectum. So there are two latera recta, just like we have in case of a ellipse. So there are two latera recta. So if I make this thing, this is also a lattice rectum. Is it fine? Any questions? Any questions? Any concerns? Okay. So two foci, two directrices corresponding to that foci. You already know what's the vertex. The line connecting the two foci is called the transverse axis. Wherever it cuts the hyperbola, they become the foci. And the line perpendicular to the transverse axis passing through the center, that line is called the conjugate axis. And a line segment joining any two points on the hyperbola, that's a chord. If the chord passes through the focus, that will be called as a focal chord. And the line perpendicular to the transverse axis and connecting two points on the hyperbola, that is called a double ordinate. And if the double ordinate passes through the focus, that double ordinate would be called as the lattice rectum. So there are two lattice rectums. Normally the word is latera recta, not lattice rectums, latera recta. Okay. So now with this information, we are ready to derive the equation of standard form of hyperbola. So if you have copied this, can I go to the next slide? Can I move on to the next slide? Okay. So the first standard form that we are going to take up, in fact, I'm going to pull out my diagram. Yeah. So in the first standard form, what I'm going to do, I'm going to assume that this is my x-axis. As you can already see in the figure also, okay, this is your x-axis. This is your x-axis. Okay, so I'm going to name my transverse axis as my x-axis. Okay. And I'm going to take the y-axis as the conjugate axis, as you can see in the diagram as well. Okay. This point that you see, let me use a green color. Yeah, this point that you see, vertex, I'm going to call it as a, 0. Okay, and I'm going to call this as minus a, 0. Okay. Now the focus, wherever it is, okay, let's say this is a focus. Let me show you with this. Yeah. These focus, I'm going to call them as C comma zero as of now. As of now. Okay. And minus C comma zero as of now. And the directrices. Let me show the directrices as well. Okay. Just going to, you know, show you some. Arbit line here. By the way, it's crossing through this. Anyways, let me do one thing. Let me show it at one place only. Okay, but I have shown in one place. So let's show in the other as well. Half, only half. I'll not make it full because I don't want the point to be cut. Yeah. So these are the two directrices, and let's say the directrices pass through D comma zero and minus D comma zero. Okay. Now there are too many variables involved. A is there, D is there, C is there, and there is already E also involved that comes from the locus definition itself. That is the distance of any point. Let's say I take any point here, S. Okay. The distance of that, sorry, take any point P, the distance of that point P from the focus S, okay, divided by the distance of that point from the directrix, that ratio is already a E, okay. Now, what I'm going to do is, just like we had done this in case of a ellipse, we are going to reduce the number of variables. We are only going to use A and E, so we are going to do away with C and D, okay. So what I'm going to do here is, I'm going to take this point. Let's call this as V point. Okay, let's call this point as V. Now this vertex V is a part of the hyperbola. So it must also satisfy the locus definition of the hyperbola. Yes or no? Correct? So can I say VS? Okay, and let me name this point as N, and let me name this point as N dash. Okay, so VS by VN, that is E, correct? Yes or no? VS, that is this distance, by VN, that is this distance, that should be equal to E. Okay, and let's do one more thing. Let's call this point as S dash, and let's call this point as N dash. I've already called it as N dash. So V S dash by V N dash will also be E. This is from the locus definition. Correct? This is from the locus definition. Now, what is V S? What is V S? So as per the diagram, you will say VS is nothing but C minus A, correct? And what is VN? VN is nothing but A minus D, correct? So this ratio is E. So from here, I end up getting C minus A as AE minus D. Let's call it as 1. Let's call this as 1. Similarly, VS dash. Okay, now write on your chat box. What do you think is VS dash? S dash is your other focus, minus C comma zero. So what is VS dash? Write it down on the chat box. VS dash. A plus C, absolutely, Mohita, or C plus A. Okay. And what is V N dash? What is the distance between V and N dash? Write that down as well. Absolutely, A plus D, correct. So from here, I end up getting C plus A as AE plus D. Let's call this as second equation. Now, in order to get C, just add both of them. Okay. If you add 1 and 2, you will end up getting 2C as 2AE. That means C is equal to AE. So I don't need to use a separate variable for C. I could use AE for it. Okay. And if you subtract the first result from the second, you get 2A as 2DE. That means D is equal to A by E. So please note this down. So C is equal to AE and D is equal to A by E. Okay. So what we have got is, let me make a fresh diagram. Let me make a fresh diagram over here. And since I would be needing this diagram, what I'll do is I'll make a proper one so that we can use it time and again. Okay, so this was our transverse axis. This was our conjugate axis. By the way, still I haven't told you why they are called conjugate axis. I will talk about it in some time, not to worry. Okay, so I am showing you right now some lines in blue, which is your directrices. And these are the two foci. Okay. You may call them as S1 and S2. Okay. Now we have already figured out that this is called A, 0. Okay. This is called -A, 0, another vertex. So two vertices, A, 0, -A, 0. And this just now we figured out it is A, 0, and this is -A, 0. Okay. And this line that you see is your x is equal to A by E. I hope I have written it over here. X is equal to D, which is X equal to A by E. Okay. And this is X equal to minus A by E. Now, for a standard case, as I already told you, let us derive the equation of this hyperbola. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take a generic point. Light is falling off. Yeah. So for a standard case, what I'm going to do is I'm going to assume a point P, moving point P, call it as H, K, and the distance of P from S1 divided by distance of P from the directrix X equal to A by E. That ratio is E. So let us use that. S1P by PM1 is equal to E. Okay. So S1P is H minus AE the whole square, K minus 0 the whole square, under root, divided by PM1. So what is PM1 distance? It is nothing but H minus A by E mod. Right? So this ratio is given to you as a E. Is it fine? Any question with respect to whatever I've written so far? Okay. So let's take this to the other side. Correct? And let's square it. Acha, by the way, since E is a positive term, you can introduce this E inside. So this E can go inside and become EH minus A. Okay. Now when you expand it, let's see what do we get. So I'm quickly expanding it over here. this plus k square is equal to eh minus a the whole square. So this is h square a square e square minus 2aeh. And from here, I'll end up getting again h square e square minus 2aeh plus a square. These two will get cancelled off. Okay. Now, let's do one thing. Let's take the h square and k square to the other side, and let's bring the a square to the left. In fact, I will write down the right side first. S square e square minus h square minus k square is equal to a square e square minus a square. In other words, you end up getting something like this. Now, divide both sides by. A square e square minus 1. Okay. So when you do that, it leaves you with h square by a square minus k square by a square e square minus 1 equal to 1. Okay. And once we have obtained it, let's generalize it. So on generalization, this gives you x square by a square minus y square by a square e square minus 1 equal to 1. Now, what do we do is here, we claim this term to be a b square. Now, let me ask you this question yet again. I have already asked this to you in your ellipse chapter. Why do you think I have called it as a b square? Means how am I sure that this quantity is going to be positive? Okay. Now the answer to this you already know. I'm just reiterating it. You already know that e is greater than 1. So e square minus 1 will be positive, correct? So even if you multiply with a square, it is not going to become any negative, right? It's still going to be positive. So something which is going to be positive, you can easily call it as a b square. So this term could easily be called as a b square, okay? I'm not writing it over here. Yeah, so this term could be easily called a b square. So you end up getting the equation of the hyperbola to be this, okay? Please make a note of this. Very, very important. Now, one important point to be noted here is that there is nothing like A greater than B, B greater than A in this case. Please don't try to apply your ellipse concept to it. Many people ask after deriving this, sir, is A greater than B here or B greater than A here? Nothing like that. Anything could be greater than anything. A could be greater than B also. B could be greater than A also. A could be equal to B also. Okay. So this is not a case where A is more than B, just like you had it in case of an ellipse, nothing like that. In case of a hyperbola, there is no major minor axis. Please understand it. Please understand this. So let me go back to that diagram. See, in this case, if I change this to 4 and this to 9, you'll see that the orientation will remain the same. Maybe there would be a change in the curvature size. Okay, so I'm just making it 9 over here. See here, curvature size of the branches will change, but it's still facing left and right. Are you getting my point? So there's no major minor thing like that. Unlike in case of an ellipse where that ellipse became vertical. That doesn't happen here. The only thing that will make this hyperbola vertical is, I'll tell you in some time, not to worry right now. Okay, I'll tell you in the second case, don't worry. Is it fine? Any questions? Is it fine? we can create a vertical hyperbola. We'll come to that. That's a different, that's a second case of a standard hyperbola. We'll talk about that also. Okay. First, let us finish this off. Okay. Let's finish this off. We have some agenda to be discussed over here. Let's do some analysis. Okay. The first thing that I would like you to observe here, very interesting observation. Okay. So in this equation, of course, your b square is a square e square minus one. In this particular equation, let's do a small activity. Let's put y as zero. Okay. When you put y as zero, you end up getting something like this, which means x square is equal to a square, which means x is equal to plus minus a. Now, this basically shows that the points of intersection with the x-axis with the x-axis are your vertices. Okay. And what are your vertices? A comma zero minus a comma zero. We have already seen it in the diagram also. Okay. Now let's put x as zero and see what happens. When you put x as zero, you'll end up getting something like this, which will actually surprise you a bit. Okay, now here people are like, sir, how is this possible? Because y square is supposed to be positive, b square is anyways positive, we have seen it. How can a positive number be negative of the other? How can a positive number be negative of the other? Now, here is the catch. If you simplify this, you get y as plus minus bi, the same I that you have in a complex number. Now, this basically tries to signifies that the hyperbola does not cut the y-axis in real points. Okay. That means it cuts the y-axis in imaginary points. Okay. And these are the two imaginary points, plus minus bi. So if you look at the diagram, let me go back again to the diagram. In fact, I will draw it once again over here. Ayo, I did not take a snapshot of the diagram. No. See how I forgot. Anyways, I'll make it quickly. Yeah. If you see, it cuts the x-axis at minus a comma zero and a comma zero. But it doesn't seem to cut the y-axis. But actually, it cuts the y-axis at imaginary points. And because it cuts at the imaginary point, you cannot see it cutting. Because in order to see, the point should be real in nature. Okay. So hypothetically, we assume that there was a point 0 comma b and 0 comma minus b. But by the way, this 0 comma b and 0 comma minus b, they are actually on the imaginary axis, okay? Not the real y-axis. So real y-axis, it will not cut. It will cut the imaginary y-axis. And these two points are actually conjugates of each other. So as we know that bi and minus bi are conjugates of each other. That is why this axis has been named as a conjugate axis. So that is why we call this as the conjugate axis. Okay. So please note, in reality, y-axis is not cut by the hyperbola. But what do we say? We justify it that the hyperbola is cutting at imaginary points, which you cannot see. Okay. And those imaginary points are bi and minus bi. Okay. So bi as a coordinate on the argand plane, we normally write it as 0 comma b. And minus bi, we normally write it as 0 comma minus b. That is why we just show them. But it is not the point, it is not the points where it is cutting the x-axis. It is just a imaginary representation of the points. They don't exist in reality. Okay. A couple of things here to be noted down. Number one, the distance between the two vertices, let me name it as V1, V2, and let me name it as PQ. Okay. So the V1, V2 distance is called the length of the transverse axis. This is called the length of the transverse axis. Transverse axis. So in our case, this length is 2a units. Okay. Similarly, PQ length, that is called the length of the conjugate axis. This is how it is defined. Axes are infinitely extending lines, right? So when we define a length, we just take that line segment and call it as a length. Okay. So this is your length of the conjugate axis. Okay. Now, a simple exercise I would like you to do it. Let's say I would like you to find out the length of the latus rectum. So let's say LR is a extremities of the latus rectum. Latus rectum is a focal cord which passes through the focus. Please, everybody, figure out the length of the latus rectum. Or length of the rata recta. Rata recta. Okay. So, for that, what we are going to do, I'm also going to help you out. This point, let's say L point is AE, K. Now, this point should satisfy. AE, K should satisfy our equation. So AE, K must satisfy our given equation, which is x square by a square minus y square by b square equal to 1. Correct? So let us put into that. So this will become a square e square minus k square b square equal to 1. So these two will get cancelled off. So e square minus 1 is k square by b square. Now all of you please note down. If you recall, I have also written it over here. Your e square minus 1 was actually b square by a square, correct? So can I not use this over here? Okay, so this e square minus 1, I can write b square by a square. So when I simplify it, I get k square as b to the power 4 by a square. That means k is plus minus b square by a. In other words, this is b square by a, and down over here, this will become minus b square by a. Okay. So what is your length of the latus rectum? So length of the latus rectum, let me complete here. Length of the latus rectum will be given by two b square by a units. Now you would say, sir, this is the same figure as what we got for ellipse. Yes, exactly the same figure. So guys, you will realize that most of the things that you have learned in ellipse, they will be in sync with whatever you have learned, whatever you're going to learn in hyperbola, like coordinates of the foci, coordinates of the vertices, equation of the directrices. Okay. Even to the extent that normally we say, many of the cases, if you replace your b square with a minus b square in a ellipse, you'll end up getting hyperbola. Okay. So if you realize in the equation itself, x square by a square plus y square by b square equal to 1, change your b square with a minus b square, you'll end up getting the equation of the hyperbola. Not only that, if you recall, in case of an ellipse, we had this relationship, b square as a square 1 minus e square. So if you change your b square with a minus b square, you'll end up getting b square as a square, e square minus 1. That is the one which is applicable for a hyperbola. So later on also, when we do higher versions of the concepts in hyperbola, you would realize that if you replace your b square with a minus b square, you'll end up getting a lot of things for hyperbola as well. Okay. So no new formula to be learned for the length of the lattice rectum. It still remains 2b square by a. Okay. So we have already covered, yeah, transverse axis, length of conjugate axis, length of lattice rectum. Okay. One final thing that we need to talk about is your eccentricity formula. So since your a square e square minus 1 is b square, it means I can write my eccentricity as under root of 1 plus b square by a square. Please note this down. Please note this down. And this is a general formula, but I'll give you a universal formula for eccentricity in this case. So universal formula for eccentricity is given by under root of 1 plus semi-conjugate square by semi-transverse square. Okay, this is a formula which is a universal formula for the case of a hyperbola. So even when we take the second standard form, which is what we are going to take up very soon, you will realize that the same formula will be valid for eccentricity even in that case as well. Is it fine? Copied? Everything done? Any questions? Okay. Now, as I told you in the beginning of this discussion on standard form of the hyperbola, that there are two standard forms. So we'll take up now the second form. And I think one of you was asking, can we not have a vertical hyperbola? Now we are going to discuss that. So let us say I have a hyperbola which is opening or whose arms are opening upwards and downwards. Okay. All right, now all of you, we'll discuss that, Anish. Okay. Now, all of you in this case, please note the critical points here. Center is still at origin. Okay. Now, as I told you, the line connecting the two foci, that is called the transverse axis. So from the given diagram, your y-axis becomes your transverse axis. Okay. And this axis, which is not cut by the hyperbola in real points, at real points, that is called the conjugate axis. Okay. So just tell you the name, you know, nomenclature for whatever you would require over here. Let's say this foci is 0, BE. Okay. This vertex is 0, B. And this is Y equal to B by E. Similarly here, this is 0, -B. This line is y equal to b by e, and this point is 0, -BE. Okay. Now I would request you all, I've already given you the directrix and the focus. In fact, two directrices and a pair of directrices and a focus is already seen on the screen. Now please derive the equation of this hyperbola and we will see what is the difference between this hyperbola and the previous one. Okay. Achha, one more thing I will tell you. Let's say hypothetically, the imaginary points or the points where it cuts the conjugate axis is a, -0, -a, 0. Yeah. Now you can use this A in your final figure of the hyperbola as well. So all of you first derive it and let me know the answer on the chat box. Correct, Anish, your answer is right. Anybody else? See, not a rocket science. Again, the process is the same. Okay. Take a point. Take a generic point, H, comma K. Take a specific point, H, comma K. Okay. And what we have learned is that the distance of P from S1 divided by distance of P from the directrix, this ratio is equal to E. Isn't it? So what is S1P under root of H minus 0 the whole square, K minus B the whole square by PM1. PM1 will be a mod of K minus B by E, correct? Let's take it to the other side. Let's take the denominator to the other side and square both the sides as well. Okay. So this will become H square, K square, B square, E square minus 2KBE. This is E square, K square, B square minus 2EK or 2KBE. Okay. 2KBE minus 2KBE will get canceled off. In this case, you take this term to the other side, this term to the other side, and this term to the left side. Okay. Let's simplify what happens. So this will become K square. E square minus 1 minus H square is equal to B square E square minus 1. Okay. Now divide both sides. By this term. So this will become K square IU. Something is happening with that. Yeah. So divide by that term. So it'll become K square. No, this is B square, not K square. B square. Yeah. So it'll become K square by B square minus H square by B square E square minus 1 equal to 1. Okay. Now generalize it. Generalize it by replacing H with X and K with Y. So when you generalize it, this becomes y square by b square minus x square by b square e square minus 1 equal to 1. Now, as I already told you, assume that the point where it is cutting the x axis is a comma 0. So put y as 0 and x as a. Okay. Which clearly means that you can replace once again. Have I missed out anything? Okay, so you have to replace it with AI, not X is AI. Yeah, so this will become a plus. Yeah, so that means you have written your B square times E square minus 1 as A square. So you can replace this whole thing with an A square. And your equation will turn out to be something like this. Okay. Or more commonly or better, we write it as this. Minus 1. Please note this down. So in the case of a vertical hyperbola, the only difference in the equation is not your values of A and B. Please note that. A and B values don't make the hyperbola become horizontal and vertical. Don't mix this with ellipse concept. In ellipse, if A is more than B, it's a horizontal. If B is more than A, it's vertical, right? But in hyperbola, A and B don't make any difference in horizontal and vertical case. If your equation is of the nature x square by a square minus y square by b square equal to 1, no matter whether A is more than B or B is more than A, it will always be having arms opening left, right. Or you can say horizontal case. If your equation is x square by a square minus y square by b square equal to minus 1, no matter whether A is more than B or B is more than A, doesn't matter. Then in that case, it will always open up and down. That means the arms will be up and down. Okay, you can call that as a vertical hyperbola. Are you getting my point here, everybody? Any questions? Okay, so we will do some analysis of this also. Like we will find out our lateral septum length. We will find out eccentricity expression. We'll also see length of the transverse and conjugate axis, all those things. So let's go to the next page and do the research work on this hyperbola. Everybody has copied it? No questions? Okay. So let's go and do some research work on this hyperbola. I'll draw the diagram again just for your convenience. Okay. Now, let us find out the length of the lateral septum. Let us first write down the length of the transverse axis. So please note, this is the length of the transverse axis, V1, V2. Okay, so this is your 0, B, 0, -B, length of transverse axis. So length of transverse axis will be 2B units. Okay. Length of conjugate axis. Two A units. Okay. Now, length of the lateral septum, let's figure that out. See, this point is 0, BE. So let's call this as L and let's call this as R. So R point, can I say, it will only have a different X coordinate, Y coordinate will still be BE only, correct? So let us use this in our equation of the hyperbola that we have just now derived. So we have just now derived that this is the equation of our hyperbola. Okay. So you put X as H and Y as BE. Okay. Let's cancel it out. So H square by A square is equal to E square minus one. Now remember, just now when I was deriving the result, let me go to the previous slide. We wrote A square as B square, E square minus one, correct? Let me replicate that on the next page also. So we wrote A square as B square, E square minus one. So from here, can I say E square minus one? I can write it as A square by B square. Okay. So I can write this as A square by B square. So H square is A to the power 4 by B square. That means H is plus minus A square by B. Correct? So this point, I can write it as this. Okay. So what is the length LR? The length LR will become 2a square by b units. Okay. By the way, I would also like to discuss with you a generic formula, your universal formula for length of lateral septum. It is applicable to both the cases. So that is why we are calling it as a universal formula. So it is always two times. Remember, it is always two times the semi-conjugate axis length square by the semi-transverse axis length. Okay. In case of a ellipse, you can write it as two times semi-minor axis square by semi-major axis. So this is a universal formula. Whether your hyperbola is of standard type 1 or standard type 2, doesn't matter. This formula will be applicable to both of them. Is it fine? Any questions? So length of transverse axis is now 2b units. Length of conjugate axis is 2a units. And lattice rectum length has now become 2a square by b. Okay. Now from our eccentricity expression here, we will can write our eccentricity as under root of 1 plus a square by b square. Mind you, the universal formula is still applicable, which was 1 plus semi-conjugate whole square by semi-conjugate whole square by semi-transverse whole square. Okay, this formula is still valid. Is this fine? Any questions, any concerns, anything that you would like to note down, please do so ASAP. Okay, now I'll do a comparative study of the two standard cases so that not only you have a clear-cut idea related to their, you know, positioning of the critical points, but you should know when to use what. Okay, so let's do a comparative study of both the standard cases. So I'll just make a bifurcation here. So the first case of a hyperbola was our this equation, okay? And the second case was this equation. Okay, the difference between the two equation is the presence of a plus one here and a minus one here. That is the main distinguishing element, right? Acha, by the way, don't expect the question setter to always give you like this only. He can, like, you know, Anish was giving the equation. He swapped the position of y and x terms and made a one there. That can also be written by the question setter. Okay. So don't expect that he will always write in the very same format in which I'm giving you. He may work around with the order and write, you know, in a different way. From diagram point of view, this is leftward, rightward opening. I'm just making a rough sketch. And this fellow is upward downward opening. Now, before I move any further, these two diagrams or these two hyperbola, they are called conjugates of each other. Okay. So these two hyperbolae are actually called conjugates of each other. So this is a conjugate hyperbola of the yellow one. Yellow one is the conjugate of the white one. Just like in complex number, we have no conjugates of a plus ib is conjugate of a minus I, and vice versa, isn't it? So both the hyperbolas are conjugates of each other. Okay. Now I'll talk about hyperbola conjugates, etc. in more detail after the semester exams. There are a lot of things that we need to discuss about them. Okay. So this is a rough diagram of the second case. Now let us write down the parameters on which we will, you know, distinguish between them. Center, how does the center change? Vertices, eccentricity, foci, equation of the directrices, equation of the directrices, let's write down equation of transverse axis, length of transverse axis, equation of conjugate axis, equation of conjugate axis, length of conjugate axis, okay. So center for both the cases is 0, 0. Vertices for this is a comma 0 and minus a comma 0, while for this it is 0 comma b and 0 comma minus b. Okay. Eccentricity in this case is 1 plus b square by a square, while in this case it is 1 plus a square by b square. Achha, one more thing I would like to discuss. So as I'm writing, some important, commonly made errors are coming. See, in case of an ellipse, if you swap your A and B positions, let's say by mistake, let's say you forgot the formula in the examination room. And if you swap the positions of A and B, that means your numerator became denominator, denominator became numerator, then automatically 1 minus that will become negative. And you'll realize that, oh, something has gone wrong because I cannot find eccentricity as root of a negative quantity. So in ellipse, even if you want to make a mistake, ellipse will not allow you to make a mistake, because the reason, if you swap A and B positions, you'll automatically get 1 minus B square by A square, or 1 minus A square by B square, whatever is the situation of the ellipse that you're dealing with, that will automatically come out to be negative. But in hyperbola doesn't give you that opportunity, or doesn't give you that safeguard, so as to say. So you can confidently make mistakes here. So be careful. Of course, don't do mistakes, but there is no mechanism by which the formula itself will save you from making a mistake. So here many people, make mistakes because there's a plus sign hidden over here. So even if you swap B square with A square with B square, you would not realize that I have made a mistake. Okay. Ellipse tells you that, you're going wrong. Okay. Because you're getting a negative answer. Okay, foci is AE comma 0 and minus AE comma 0. In this case, the foci is 0 comma B and 0 comma minus B. Equation of the directrices is X equal to A by E and X equal to minus A by E. And in this case, it is Y equal to B by E and Y equal to minus B by E. Okay, achha, one more thing I forgot, lattice rectum length. That is also important. Parameter, length of lattice rectum. Okay. Yeah. Transverse axis equation in this case is your x axis. In this case, it is your y axis. And length of the transverse axis is 2a. Okay. In this case, it is 2b. Equation of the conjugate axis is y axis in this case, and in this case it is your x axis. Length of conjugate axis is 2b, and in this case it is 2a. Okay. Length of the lattice rectum in this case is 2b square by a, but in this case it is 2a square by b. Is it fine? So this comparative chart, everybody please note this down, and more importantly, it should be noted here in your mind, not anywhere else. Clear? Any questions? Clear? Anybody? Any doubt? Please do let me know. Okay. Let's take questions. Can you go a bit down? Yeah, sure, Abhay. Very good. Let's do a question. I'll first begin with a question where I will test your locus understanding of how to get the equation. Once you know, focus and the corresponding directrix, and of course, yes, the eccentricity. So here goes the first question. Find the equation of the hyperbola whose directrix is 2x plus y equal to 1. Focus is 1,0 and eccentricity is root 3. Please solve this. If you don't want to type your answer, just say done. That is also fine with me. Yes, done. Anybody with success? Yeah. So y equal to 1 minus 2x. It will be a line like this. Okay. focus is at 1, 2. Somewhere over here. Okay, this is your focus. Right? Now there's a point P which is moving in such a way. Let's say I call this as a point P, H, K. Okay. And this point P is moving in such a way that the ratio of its distance from S to dat from the given directrix, that ratio is root 3. So SP by PM is equal to root 3. That means SP square is 3 PM square. Now what is SP square? SP square is H minus 1 square, K minus 2 square. 3 times. Oh, very good, Abhay. We'll see whether that is correct or not. Is 3 times PM square. PM square, the distance of P from M will be 2H plus K minus 1 by root 5 the whole square. Isn't it? So let's try to simplify this a bit. So 5 times H minus 1 the whole square plus K minus 2 the whole square is 3 times 2H plus K minus 1 the whole square. Let's simplify this. So when I expand it, I already know that I'm going to get a 5H square from here and I'm going to get a 12H square from here, right? So why not we, you know, simplify it and make it as 7H square. Okay, so H square is taken care of. Here I will get 5K square and here I will get 3K square. So it will become minus 2K square. And this will become 4HK and into 3. So that will become 12HK. Okay, and this is going to give you a minus 4H, minus 12H. And from here, I'm going to get a minus 10H. So that is going to give you minus 2H. Correct? Any questions? And from here, I will end up getting a minus 6K. And this is minus 20K. Okay. So that will go there and become 14K. And constant terms here would be 25. And from here, I'll get a 3. So that's minus 22 equal to 0. Now you can see yourself that how ugly an equation of a hyperbola can be, provided you just make its transverse or conjugate axis inclined at a certain non-zero angle with the, you know, coordinate axis. So just let's generalize it. So on generalization, you'll end up getting 7x square. Okay, Abhay, Mavita, you got the same result or something else? We'll do one thing. We will check our answers with GeoGebra as well. So let me just copy this means I'll just take a snapshot on my phone. Yeah, let's copy this on GeoGebra. Let's delete these. So our equation was 7x square minus 2y square plus 2xy minus 2x plus 14y minus 22 equal to 0. Okay. So as you can see, it's a slightly inclined version of the hyperbola. Okay. So this is how the hyperbola looks. Now, thankfully, I can easily figure out the foci from the tool itself. I'm so sorry, 12xy. Okay. Thank you for letting me know that. Okay, as you can see, A is already 1, 2. Okay. Of course, there is one more focus which I don't need it, which I did not need while I was finding the equation. I don't need it right now. And let's also figure out the directrix. Directrix of, yeah. So two directrices, as you can see here. Okay, one directrix is, yes. As you can see, this is 2x plus y equal to 1. Please don't go by the, you know, exactness of the value. It's considered to be 0.9 because the tool makes it from their own. There is some technical glitch that happens. So it is 2x. If you divide by 0.45, it is 2x plus y equal to 1. Okay. Other one, of course, is. Other one, of course, is if you divide it by 0.9, it becomes x plus y by 2 equal to minus 1. Okay. So this is the one which was of, you know, requirement to us. Is it fine? So whatever we have done is absolutely right. Any questions, any concerns? Should we go to the next question? Okay, let's move on to the next question. So this is a typical school level question. Find the length of transverse axis, conjugate axis, eccentricity, coordinates of foci, vertices, length of LR, equation of directrices for the following hyperbolas. Let's do the first one. I would request you all to give me all these answers in a single shot. Okay. Don't like, you know, find one thing and press and enter, find another thing, press and enter. I want it to be at one place. So once you've written all of them, then only go for a press and enter. Okay. So that I don't get confused who has answered with what. First one done. Correct. So this clearly means A is 1/3, B is 1. Okay, again, don't take a call based on A and B value, which is greater than what doesn't make any difference. There's a 1 here, so it will be a case of a left and rightward opening branches of a hyperbola. So this will be your case, okay? Just because B is more than A doesn't become vertical. It is not an ellipse situation. I'm repeating it time and again. Right? So now close your eyes and remember everything that you have learned about the case where the hyperbola opened left and right. So in this case, our length of transverse axis. So the first part of the question. Length of transverse axis. Okay. So this length is going to be 2a. correct? Is it fine? Any questions? Second was length of conjugate axis, which is 2b. Okay. So let the conjugate axis be bigger than the transverse axis, not an issue at all, because they are not called major minor, for your kind information. Major minor is in ellipse. In the case of hyperbola, any axis can be greater than the other one. Doesn't matter at all. Okay. Next, eccentricity. Now here, eccentricity is under root of 1 plus b square by a square. Okay. So b square is 1. A square will be 1 by 9. So 9 will go up. So that will be a root of 10 units. Correct. Next, foci. Foci is AE comma 0 minus AE comma 0. So AE and minus AE. Is it fine? Any questions? Vertices. Vertices a comma 0 minus a comma 0. Okay. Next, length of LR. In this case, it is 2b square by a. Correct? So 2b square by a will be 6 units. Next. Last one. Equation of the directrices. So directrices in this case will be x equal to a by e. So a by e, a is this, okay, and x equal to minus a by e. Is it fine? Anybody who got all of these in the same values? Any questions? But got it late. Never mind. The second problem is always there. Okay, so I'll just copy paste it here. So I'll take the problem once again, the second part on the next sheet. Let's do this. And this time I'll be giving you time. Okay. Take time, write it down, and then let me know the results. Yes, waiting for your response. Oh, wow. Well done, Momita. Very good. Anybody else? Okay, let's discuss it out. First of all, we all realize that this equation can also be written like this. Okay. The presence of a minus one shows that it's a vertical case, or it's the conjugate of the first case. Okay. Now, whatever you know about this kind of a hyperbola, just remember that and start answering these questions. So in this case, the length of the transverse axis is 2b units. Now here, remember, a is 3 and b is 4. So the answer to the first part is 8 units, which is 2b. Yes or no? Answer to the conjugate axis is 2a, 6 units. Eccentricity in this case is 1 plus semi-conjugate. Semi-conjugate by semi-transverse. Okay. So that is going to give you a 5/4. Foci is 0, BE and 0, -BE. Vertices 0, B and 0, -B. Lattice sectum is 2a² / b, which in this case is 9/2 units. Directrices is y is equal to b/e. b/e will be 16/5 and y equal to -b/e. These are your answers to this question. Let me check Momita's answer. 8, 6. Awesome. Very good. 10 on 10. All right. Any questions, any concerns here, anybody? All right, let's take another question. Find the eccentricity of the hyperbola whose lattice sectum is half of its transverse axis. Find the eccentricity of the hyperbola whose lattice sectum is half of its transverse axis. Very good, Mohita. Okay, should we discuss it? Anybody else who would like to answer this? Okay, Lavanya. Lattice rectum length is half the length of the transverse axis. Okay, so what does it mean? It means, oh, I'm so sorry. Yeah, it means 2b square is equal to a square. So b square by a square is half. And for such cases where you have assumed this to be your lattice rectum length and this to be your transverse axis, in those cases, eccentricity formula is this. Right? Because you may ask me this question, why this formula? Why not 1 plus a square by b square formula? If that is the case, then change your lattice rectum formula over here as well. Change your length of transverse axis here as well. Okay? So if you're going to make a change in the eccentricity formula, you must make a change in the lattice rectum formula first of all over here, and your transverse axis length over here. So ultimately your end result is going to be the same, which is going to be under root of 3/2. Is it fine? Any questions? Simple question. Any questions, any concerns, anybody, please do let me know. I think let's take this one. Root of 3/2. This was the form answer. Root of 3/2. Right, Samarth? All right. Let's take this one up. The foci of a hyperbola coincides with the foci of the ellipse. Find the equation of the hyperbola if its eccentricity is 2. If its eccentricity is 2. Done. Anybody with any response? So this is your ellipse. Of course, your A is 5, B is 3, and your A is greater than B. Okay, so it's a case of a horizontal ellipse. Okay, so let's figure out first a few things. What are the coordinates of the foci for this case? And do we actually need it? To be more precise, do we actually need it? Do we need to know the coordinates of the foci in this case? Many of you are still trying, I believe. So should I give you more time or should we discuss it? What do you think? Okay, Lavanya, very good. So Lavanya has responded. Anybody else who would like to respond? Okay. Now for this ellipse, what is the eccentricity? It's 1 minus. Now see, this is what I was trying to say. Let's say if you misuse the formula, you will immediately realize that this is wrong because you'll end up getting a negative answer here. Okay. So that is what I was trying to say. Even if you want to make a mistake, the formula will not allow you to make a mistake. Okay. So ideally speaking, this is the eccentricity for this ellipse, right? So this will become 4/5, if I'm not mistaken. So the distance between the two foci, the distance between the foci will be 2AE, which in this case is 8 units. And this is supposed to be the distance between the foci of our hyperbola as well. Let me write it like this. So same should be the distance between the foci of the hyperbola as well. Correct. So 2AE, but remember E is 2 here. 2AE is 8, so A value is 2. Correct? Yes or no? Now, these are your two foci. Your hyperbola has to be leftward and rightward opening, right? This can be your hyperbola, correct? So it's a case where your equation is x² / a² - y² / b² equal to 1. A value I've already figured out. And in this case, our b square is a² / e² - 1, which is nothing but 4 × e². E square is again 2² - 1, which is 12. Correct? So let's write down our final equation. So a square is 4, b square is 12. So our final equation of the hyperbola will become x² / 4 - y² / 12 equal to 1. Is it correct? Any questions? Absolutely right. I think Lavanya got it exactly correct. Any questions? Any concerns? Okay, so please do not waste time finding the foci of the ellipse because they will be of no use to you in solving the question. Okay, anyways, we'll make a move to the next part of the question. Obtain the equation of a hyperbola with coordinate axis as principal axis. Principal axis means transverse and conjugate. Given that the distances of one of its vertices from the foci are 9 and 1 units. So one of the vertices is distance from one focus is 9 and the other focus is 1. You may assume any of the two forms. That doesn't matter. Okay. I'm fine with you assuming a vertical hyperbola or you assuming a horizontal hyperbola. So two answers will come as a result of that. But you can go for any one of the answers. Done. Okay, in this case, you can assume this to be 1 and this to be 9. Yes, anybody with his or her response? Okay, what is given to you is AE minus A is 1 and AE plus A is 9. That's what has been given to you in the question, isn't it? Correct? So just add it. 2 AE is 10. So AE is 5. Okay. Subtract it. 2 A is 8. So A is 4. So E is 5 by 4. Okay. So A is 4, E is 5 by 4. And we already know that B square is A square, E square minus 1. So B square is A square, E square minus 1. That will leave you with a 9. Right. So your answer would be X square by A square minus Y square by B square equal to 1. That's your answer. Is it fine? Any questions, any concerns? Okay, let's take. If E and E dash are the eccentricities of these two hyperbola, then 1 by E and 1 by E dash lies on which of the following curves? I'm launching a poll for it.
Okay, very good. I got one response. Yes, anybody else? 3 minutes about to get over. Let me stop the poll in the next 15 seconds. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go. Okay. So four of you have only voted for this question, and all of you have voted for option A. Okay, let's check. See, both of these are actually equations of hyperbole which open left and right. So this one, okay. So E dash is under root of 1 plus B square by A square, which is literally in this case B square by A square, which means, sorry, why E dash E? Which means E square is A square plus B square by A square. Let's call it as one. The second one will satisfy under root of 1 plus, now in this case it will become A square by B square. Because A has now become B, B has now become A, but the formula still remains the same. So from here I can say E dash square is B square plus A square by B square. Okay, let's do a simple activity here. Let us reciprocate both of these first and the second equation and add them. So the, yeah, so this expression will become this, which clearly becomes A square plus B square upon A square plus B square, which is actually a 1, right? That means if I take this as a point X, so 1 by E is your X and 1 by E dash is your Y, it implies that X square plus Y square is actually a 1. Okay. Now here, something very interesting I would like to highlight since this question was asked. Please note this down. Let us say this is your hyperbola whose eccentricity is E. Okay. And this is the conjugate of that hyperbola. Okay, whose eccentricity is E dash? Okay, so please note here that 1 by E square, 1 by E dash square will actually be a 1. Very, very important result. Please note down. Let me write it properly. I'll still think as it's e to the power of 12. Yeah, so E dash, 1 by E dash square plus 1 by E square is actually a 1. Is it fine? Any questions, any concerns? Please highlight. Okay. So this is a property which is true in general also. That means if there is a hyperbola and its conjugate, their eccentricities, reciprocal squares will add up to give you a 1. Okay, so this is a property kind of a thing. Fine. All right, so we'll take a break right now. On the other hand, of the, side of the break, we will take up shifted cases of hyperbola. For that, I don't need to tell you any theory. You have already done ellipse and parabola. Exactly the same approach is applied for hyperbola as well. Okay, so we'll take that up on the other side of the break. Let's meet at 6:22 p.m. after a short 15 minutes break. All right, see you on the other side. So the next point of agenda for us in hyperbola would be discussing shifted hyperbola, okay, or what we call as the generalized hyperbola. So as we have already seen in case of parabola, ellipse, and now we are seeing in case of a hyperbola, that if you shift a standard case, so any of the two standard cases, whether it's a vertical opening, whether it's a horizontal opening, so whichever of the two cases you take and you shift that case in such a way that the center no longer remains at origin, but yes, the principal axis, that is your conjugate axis and your transverse axis, is still parallel to the coordinate axis. Those are called the shifted hyperbolic case. Okay, so I'll write it down over here that this is a case of shifting of center to a point other than the origin. Point other than the origin. But keeping the principal axis, or you can say the transverse and the conjugate axis to be more precise, I write it down. But keeping the transverse and conjugate axes parallel to the coordinate axes. Okay. So despite shifting the origin, the transverse and the conjugate axis still remain to be parallel to the coordinate axes. Okay. So a typical such case would look like this. So let us say this was your initial position of the hyperbola. Okay, the dotted one. Now, let's say I shift the origin of the hyperbola in such a way that the hyperbola now becomes something like this. I'm just making a diagram. Okay. So the center has now come to alpha comma beta. Okay. And this is your new, let me make it in blue color. This is your new transverse axis. And this is your new conjugate axis. Okay. So earlier it was like this. Earlier it was in this position. Okay. This was your equation also. And now this hyperbola has been shifted to this position. So now these are your two arms. Okay. So you note here that the transverse axis still remains parallel to the X axis. And this still remains parallel to the Y axis. Okay. So in such cases, the equation will change to, as we have already seen before, and we will not be deliberating on it again and again. So we have already seen that shifting changes the equation to this. Okay. And not only that, we should also be aware that how does the other coordinates, like the foci coordinates, they change, the vertices, they change. What happens to the equation of the transverse and the conjugate axis? What happens to the equation of the directrices? All of these facts have been already covered under ellipse and parabola, and the same is going to apply yet again to hyperbola. So there's nothing new to be discussed over here. Okay, so your role change method is going to work here as well. If you have forgotten it, maybe we can take it through a simple example just to revisit the concept again. Let's say I start with this question. Find the center, vertices, foci, equation of directrices. For something like this, x plus 1 the whole square by 4 minus y minus 2 the whole square by 9 equal to 1. Okay. So the moment you see this, you realize that, oh, this is a case where your standard hyperbola has been shifted. Okay. So just do a role change here. Compare it with this hyperbola. Compare it with this hyperbola. Okay. So here, if you see, A role is being played by 2, B role is being played by 3, capital X role is being played by X plus 1, and capital Y role is being played by Y minus 2. Okay. Now let's try to understand, how do we find these coordinates and equations? So center, where was center for this hyperbola? Center for this hyperbola was at 0, 0. So write that like this, x equal to 0, y equal to 0, and just do a role change. So instead of capital X, put small x plus 1. Instead of capital Y, put small y minus 2. So x becomes negative 1, y becomes 2. Now I hope this helps you to, you know, recall whatever we had done in our previous two conics. Right? Next, vertices. Vertices for this hyperbola used to be at a comma 0 and minus a comma 0 and minus a comma 0. Correct? So now let's do a rule change. Capital X is x plus 1, small x plus 1, a is 2 as per the given question. Correct? And y is nothing but small y minus 2. So solving it gives you x as 1 and y as 2. That means 1 comma 2 is one of the vertices. And same here also, x plus 1 is minus 2, y minus 2 is 0. So minus 3 comma 2 is your another vertex. Is it clear? Any questions? Any questions? Next, foci. For foci, I need eccentricity. So first thing is eccentricity. So for such kind of hyperbola, eccentricity is 1 plus b square by a square, which is under root of 1 plus, okay, b square. B square is 9, a square is 4. So it's under root of 13 by 2. Okay. So let's now find out the foci. Foci is at AE comma 0 and minus AE comma 0. Okay. So capital X is X plus 1 equal to AE. I think A value was 2 and E value was root 13 by 2. So this will be root 13. And this is y minus 2 equal to 0. So your coordinate will become root 13 minus 1 comma 2. And this guy will give x plus 1 equal to minus root 13. And y minus 2 is equal to 0. So this will give us the coordinate as minus root 13 minus 1 comma 2. Is it fine? Any questions? Now, coming to the equation of the directrices. So directrices for such cases. Directrices for such cases is x equal to a by e. And x equal to minus a by e. So x equal to a by e. A is 2. So a by e will be 4 by root 13. Okay, and the next one will be x plus 1 is equal to minus 4 by root 13. Of course, you can simplify it. Okay, you can put the 4 by root 13 to the left side also, and in this case also, but that is not my agenda. Is it fine? Is the approach clear? Everybody has now successfully recalled, right, what we had done in our parabola and ellipse cases as well. Okay, any questions, anybody? Okay. So can we take one more set of questions? Okay, let's take. Find the center vertices, eccentricity, foci, directrices, lattice sector length, equation of transverse axis, equation of conjugate axis, length of transverse axis, length of conjugate axis. So let's do all of them. Okay. I think we have not left anything. For equal to minus one, equal to minus one. Yes, done, anybody? Should we discuss it now? See, again, the minus one shows that it's a case of a vertical ellipse, sorry, vertical hyperbola. So center is 0, 0, right? So you have to put x as 0, y as 0. So that will give you minus 2 and y as 2. So center is minus 2, comma 2. Okay, this is your center. Now, vertices in this case is 0b and 0 minus b. This is your vertices. That means x plus 2 is 0. Okay. And y minus 2 is b. Now, in this case, your a is 3 and b is 2. That means minus 2, comma 4 and minus 2, comma 0. That will become your vertices. That will become your vertices for this question. Is it fine? Very good, Lavanya. Lavanya has given the response. Eccentricity. Eccentricity in this case is given by under root of 1 plus a square by b square, which is 1 plus 9 by 4, which is root 13 by 2. Okay. Foci. Foci is at 0, comma BE and 0, comma minus BE. Okay. So that is x plus 2 is equal to 0 and y minus 2 is equal to BE. Now, B into E will be, if I'm not mistaken, root 13. Okay. Similarly here, this is 0 and y minus 2 equal to minus root 13. Okay. So this is minus 2 comma 2 plus root 13. And minus 2 comma 2 minus root 30. Is it fine? Any questions? Any questions? Any concerns so far? Next is directrices equation. Directrices equation would be y equal to b by e and y equal to minus b by e. So y is nothing but y minus 2. Correct? Equal to b by e. So b in this case is 2. So b by e will be 4 by root 13. 4 by root 13. And y minus 2 is minus 4 by root 13. You can just write it as y equal to 2 plus 4 by root 13 also. And y equal to 2 minus 4 by root 13 also. Is it fine? Next, length of the lattice rectum. Since it is a case of a vertical hyperbola, length of the lattice rectum will be 2a square by b units, which is 2 into a square. In this case, I think a square is going to be 9. So that is nothing but 9 units. Is it fine? Any questions? Next. Equation of transverse axis. Okay. Transverse axis in this case is your in case of a vertical hyperbola, transverse axis is your y-axis, right? Which is capital X equal to 0. That means x plus 2 equal to 0 will be your answer. Okay. Is it fine? And this will be y minus 2 equal to 0. Okay. Now, length of the transverse axis. Length of the transverse axis will be 2b units in this case, which is going to be 2 into 2, which is 4 units. Correct? Okay. No issues. And length of the conjugate axis will be 2B units, which is 6 units. Sorry, 2A, which is 6 units. Okay. Please remember, this is 2B and this is 2A. Any questions? Any questions, any concerns here? Okay, so I think one question is good enough. Now we'll take some generic questions on the same. But if you have any doubts, any questions, any concerns, please immediately highlight. All right, let's take let's take this question. Find the equation of the hyperbola whose foci are at these two positions and eccentricity is 3. Yes, anybody? See, as per the question, these are the two foci. Okay, so basically it is trying to suggest you that it's a case of a shifted hyperbola, and that hyperbola was originally opening left and right. Correct. So what are the things that we need to note while you are writing the equation? Of course, we need to know the center. Okay. Now, center is very easy to find out. Center is actually the midpoint. I'm so sorry. I swapped the position. This is minus 2 comma 5. Yeah, center is actually the midpoint of the given two foci. Okay. So the midpoint will be at 4 comma 5. This is the midpoint. So this will be your center. Okay. Another important thing to be noted down is we need A and B values. Now, we all know that distance between the two foci is 2AE. So 2AE is equal to 12. Correct? So AE is equal to 6 and eccentricity is given to you as 3. So A is 2. Correct? And we also know that B square is A square, E square minus 1. Correct. So taking everything into the consideration that it is the case of a shifted hyperbola, that means its center is no longer at origin and A value is 2, B value is root 32. In light of all these things, your equation will turn out to be x minus 4 the whole square by A square minus y minus b the whole square, sorry, y minus 5 the whole square by b square equal to 1. Is it fine? Anybody who got this answer? Anybody? Excellent, Momita. Very good. Okay. Any questions, any concerns anybody has, do let me know. All right. So let's move on to the next question. Okay. I have a very plain and simple question over here. Find the center, eccentricity, and length of the transverse and conjugate axes for this hyperbola. So here the problem is we have been given the equation not in the form that we have been seeing it so far, because that makes it very predictable, right? You're able to just, you know, do a role change mechanism and find all your required points and equations conveniently from that. Instead, the question setter has basically complicated it by expanding the entire scenario. But nevertheless, it is actually testing you on your art of completing the square. So let's do that and let's figure out what is the center eccentricity and the length of the axis. Anybody who's able to do it, do let me know. Or should I wait for some time? One more minute I can give you all. Oh, very good, Momita. Okay. See, normally when I solve these kind of questions, I group all the x, y's and constants, you know, in separate camps. Okay. So x camp, y camp, constant camp. So here, if you take 3 common, you get x square minus 2x. Here you take minus 5 common, you get y square minus 4y. Okay. Just do a small activity. Put a plus 1 here. But when you put a plus 1 here, you have to put a plus 3 here because you are actually adding a 3. Right. Put a plus 4 here. But when you're adding a plus 4, you are actually adding a minus 20. So you have to add a minus 20 here as well. Okay, Abhay, we'll check. Is it fine? So this simplifies to 3 times x minus 1 the whole square minus 5 times y minus 2 the whole square. This will be 32 minus 17, which is 5. Correct? Any questions? So x minus 1 the whole square upon 5 by 3 minus y minus 2 whole square upon 1 is equal to. Is equal to 15. I'm so sorry. 15. So this will be 5 and this will be 3. Yeah. Okay. So look and feel says that it's a case of a shifting of a horizontal hyperbola. So A is root 5, B is root 3. Now let's try to answer what do they want. They want us to find the center. Center is where capital X, which is your X minus 1, is 0. And capital Y, which is Y minus 2, is 0. So X is 1, Y is 2. 1 comma 2 is the center. So this is your answer to the center. Next, eccentricity. Eccentricity in this case is under root of 1 plus b square by a square, right? Which in this case is 2 root 2 by 5, by root 5. Okay. Next is length of the transverse axis, which is 2 root 5 and 2 root 3. So your transverse axis length is 2 root 5 units and conjugate axis length is 2 root 3 units. Is it fine? Now, let us talk about the parametric equation of the hyperbola. Just like we had taken parametric equations for circles, parabola, we'll take the same for hyperbola as well. Okay, any questions anybody has? Anybody wants to note down anything? All right. Now, for a standard case of a hyperbola, let's take this standard case first. For this case, we normally, so let's say this is the Cartesian form. For this case, we normally use this as the parametric form, where theta is a parameter in this case. Okay. So this is a parametric form or a suggested parametric form. As I already told you, parametric form is not fixed, right? Nobody can say this is the only parametric form for this. No, nobody can say like that. There can be several parametric forms. So this is one of the mostly used or suggested parametric forms. It basically comes from your derived Pythagorean identity, that secant square theta or secant square any angle minus tan square an angle, okay, is equal to 1. So it comes from that. But here in this parametric form, I would like you to understand certain things. What does this theta actually represent over here? So let me just show you something very important over here. We'll be discussing about it a little later on also in our further discussions of hyperbola after your school exams are over. Okay, so let's say this is our x square by a square minus y square by b square equal to 1. Okay. Now let us say I take a point over here, P. Okay, and I call it as a sec theta comma b tan theta. Okay. Now many people, when I ask them, what is this theta here? Can you show me the theta in this diagram? Many people tell me, sir, theta is this angle. Okay, let me tell you, this is wrong. This is not theta. By the way, theta is also called the eccentric angle of that point. Okay. I'm not going to go into depth of it because anyways, we are going to cover it up a little later on. Okay. Not required for your school. Hence, I'm not going to the depth of it. So theta is actually called the eccentric angle of that point. Of that point P. Okay. So this point P, eccentric angle is theta. Now let me actually show you what is theta in this case. Let's make a circle. Let's make a circle with center at C and radius as the length of, or you can say A as your radius. Okay. This circle, later on you will learn, the name is called auxiliary circle. Okay. This is called an auxiliary circle. So what is an auxiliary circle? It's a circle whose center is same as that of the hyperbola and whose radius is nothing but, or whose diameter is nothing but the length of the transverse axis. Okay. Now, from this point P, you drop a perpendicular. Okay. Let's say it hits the x-axis or the transverse axis at M. From this point M, you draw a tangent to this circle. Oh, sorry. Okay, let's say the tangent hits the circle at this point Q. This theta that you are seeing over here is actually the angle between CQ and the x-axis. This is the theta. And not this one, which many people say, no, please don't say this is theta. It would be wrong. Okay. Now I can justify it also. It's very easy to justify. See, this is already A. So this will also be A. And if this is theta, this length CM, that will be A sec theta. Correct. And if you put A sec theta in this equation of your hyperbola, so you'll have a square secant square by a square, which is secant square theta, minus y square by b square equal to 1, which clearly gives you y square by b square is secant square theta minus 1, which is tan square theta. So y square is equal to b square tan square theta. So y is equal to plus minus b tan theta. By the way, plus minus because for the same a, you can have a point minus b tan theta also over here. So I'm not interested in that, but I still get that the y coordinate is y, but the y coordinate is b tan theta in this case. Okay. In other words, what I wanted to explain here is that when you write down the coordinates of a point using the parametric equation a sec theta b tan theta, theta is not the angle between C to P. Don't make that mistake. How is theta obtained? From P, drop a perpendicular on the transverse. From there, you sketch a tangent to the auxiliary circle. Point of tangency connected to the center. This angle is called the eccentric angle of that point. Okay. Is it fine? Any questions? Don't worry, we'll be speaking about it in details. We'll be talking about it in detail also in our higher versions or higher discussions of this topic. Okay, this topic has just actually started. Okay, is it fine? Any questions? Now, similarly, many people ask me, sir, for the other case of a hyperbola, which is the conjugate of this, what is the recommended parametric form? Okay, let's write that down also. So for this case, this is our Cartesian form. For this case, it is A tan theta and B sec theta. Okay, where theta is a parameter. So this is the parametric form. Is it fine? Any questions? Okay. So with this, I'll take a small problem associated with it. Okay, let's take this question. Prove that this point lies on the hyperbola. By the way, the right way to read this question is, if somebody gives you a parametric form of a curve like this, you have to show that this is the parametric form of a hyperbola, right? That is, we need to show that this is a parametric form of a hyperbola. In short, we need to know what is the Cartesian form. So for this hyperbola, what is the Cartesian form? So please tell me the Cartesian form for this. Remember, while finding the Cartesian form, you just have to get rid of the parameter involved. That's it. Done. Anybody with any success? So eliminate the t from these two equations. Tell me what do you see. Do you get a hyperbola's equation or not? You get it? Okay. So how do you do this question? Okay, I'll show you a very convenient way to do this question. So from the first equation, can I say 2x by a is this? Or can I say if I square it up, I get something like t square plus 1 by t square plus a 2. Similarly, from the second equation, I get 2y by b as t minus 1 by t. That means on squaring it, I'll get t square plus 1 by t square minus 2. Okay. Subtract both the results. You'll end up getting a 4. Drop the 4. And this clearly represents a hyperbola. Okay. So what do you see? What is the moral of the story? The thing to be learned here is that I wrote in the previous slide as a sec theta and b tan theta, right? As x and y. This is an alternative way. As I told you, as I keep telling you, parametric forms are not fixed. So this is yet another parametric form for the same hyperbola. Are you getting my point? Okay. So this is yet another parametric form for the same hyperbola. Later on, when you learn hyperbolic functions, hyperbolic trigonometric functions, you will understand that there are few more parametric forms which are very commonly used. Okay. Anyways, with this, we will now talk about an alternative locus definition of a hyperbola. Another locus definition. So in the very first slide of our session today, we discussed that hyperbola is defined as the locus of a point moving in a plane such that the ratio of its distance from a fixed point to that from a fixed line, that's a constant whose value is more than one, right? Now there's another locus definition, and this locus definition goes like this. A hyperbola is the locus of a point, or it's a path traced by a point, moving in a plane, okay, in such a way that the difference of its distances, from two fixed points is a constant. So please note this down. I'll repeat this definition once again. It's a path traced by a point moving in such a plane that the difference of its distances from two fixed points is a constant. Now these distances that I'll be talking about, these are called the focal radii. Okay, we'll talk about it. And these two fixed points that I'm talking about, these are your foci. And this constant that I'm talking about is actually the length of the transverse axis. Okay. So now let me show this, that why this locus definition actually is fulfilled by a hyperbola. Okay. In a hyperbola, why does the difference of the focal radii of any point, focal radii of any point means focal distance of that point, okay, is a fixed value, and that fixed value is actually the length of the transverse axis. Okay. So what I'm going to do here is, I'm going to take any generic point h comma k. Okay. And this is one of the foci. Let's say I call it as S1. And this is another foci. Let's call it as S2. Okay. Now, what is S1P and what is S2P? Let us try to find it out. S1P, you don't have to use the distance between 2 point formula. You can use that. It is E times PM1. And what is M1? M1 is nothing but the foot of the perpendicular dropped from this point onto the directrix. Okay, I'm just making a small directrix over there. Okay, so what is this length? This length is going to be H minus A by E. So if you expand it, you get EH minus A. This is S1P. Okay. Similarly, what is S2P? S2P will be E times PM2. And that is nothing but E times H plus A by E, which is EH plus A. Correct. Now, what you realize is that if you take the difference of S1P and S2P, difference means absolute value of the subtraction of these two answers, you'll end up getting 2A. And this 2A happens to be the length of the transverse axis. So this is yet another locus definition of a hyperbola. That in a hyperbola, any point satisfies the fact that the difference of its distances from the two foci is a constant. Again, I'll repeat. The difference of the two focal distances is a constant, and that constant value is the length of the transverse axis. Always, please note this down. This is the locus definition of any hyperbola, no matter whether it is a standard case or non-standard case, this definition will be satisfied. Okay. All right. So we'll take some generic questions. Okay, so a few generic questions that is required for your school exams. We'll take that up, okay? Because we have almost covered all the subject matter required for your school purposes, okay? So we'll take few questions from here and there. Let's take this one. I'll put the poll on for this. What is the eccentricity of this conic? Now, in the present context, this question becomes very easy because, as you can see, since we are doing hyperbola, none of these options will, you know, suit a hyperbola, right? A hyperbola eccentricity cannot be 1. It cannot be half. It can minus 1 is out of question. So, only option that seems to be feasible is D. Okay. But anyways, I'm assuming that we are doing hyperbola. That's why D is the right option. Okay. But let us say if I remove the options from my mind or from my, you can say, option list. Let's solve it then. Okay. Now, as I told you, start completing the square. Okay. So in such cases, eccentricity is 1 plus a square by b square. That's nothing but root 2. Later on, we'll come to know that it's a type of a rectangular hyperbola. Okay. So the answer in the present question is option D. Now, I just wanted to see the presence of mind, but only 3 of you responded with D. Many people did not respond. That is not because of the presence of mind, because they are not paying attention to the class, which they will realize. Very soon they will realize, once the right time comes, that they have missed out on a lot of things. And that time it will become very difficult for them to go back and catch it up. Time is the best, you know, teacher. It can teach you lessons which nobody else can teach. Okay, let's take this one. I'll put the poll on for this as well. Read the question carefully. It says, find the eccentricity of a hyperbola conjugate to this fellow. Conjugate to this fellow. Okay, should we discuss it? Okay, Anish, we'll discuss it. See, first of all, if you write this equation, this you can add a one here. So you'll have x minus one the whole square. Okay, divide by nine throughout. Okay. Now here, a is three, b is root three. Eccentricity will be under root of 1 plus b square by a square. Correct? Which in this case will be b square by a square. Okay, 1 by 3. So it's going to be 2 by root 3. Correct? I'm just stopping the poll in case, okay, 4 of you have voted for C option only. Okay, let's check. Yeah, now we have already learned that if e dash or let e dash be the eccentricity of its conjugate. Eccentricity of the conjugate of this hyperbola. Okay. Then can I say 1 by e square plus 1 by e dash square should be equal to 1? Remember, this is one of the properties which I gave you early on. Okay. So which means 3 by 4 plus 1 by e dash square is equal to 1. That means 1 by e dash square is equal to 1/4, which means e dash square is equal to 4, which means e dash has to be 2. Please note, no plus minus business. Only 2 will be the answer. Eccentricity is a positive quantity because it is the ratio of two distances. Okay. So option number C becomes the right option. Right. So I think we have done more than what is required for school. At least, you know, first from school point of view, we are much ahead. Okay. Our next class that we'll be having